وظیفه مهمان من در بخش حقوق و آزادی‌های مدنی در وزارت امنیت ملی آمریکا مقابله با تروریسم است، ولی نه با اسلحه و شیوه‌های جاسوسی و خبرگیری. کار او باز کردن چشم و گوش هموطنانش به خطر تروریسم و ایجاد همبستگی بیشتر بین آمریکایی‌ها از تبارهای مختلف، به خصوص آمریکایی‌های عرب تبار و مسلمان است. وظیفه بس خطیر، ولی خطر داخلی تروریسم برای آمریکا چقدر جدی است؟ جورج سلیم، ویلکم تو به عبارت دیگر.
سلام، گود تو بی ویت یو.
Thank you. Mr. Salim, what the post of policy advisor at the Homeland Security entails? What does it do?
So, my job is I work in the Office for Civil Rights and Civil Liberties at the Department of Homeland Security headquarters, and we work as a legal and policy advisor office to the secretary and all senior officials across the department on issues that we say are at the intersection of civil liberties and homeland security.
There's one part of your duty is basically to help official when engaging with the ethnic and religious minorities. Yes. Can you describe exactly what you do in that area?
Part of the work of the Civil Rights and Civil Liberties Office is reaching out to ethnic and religious minority communities across the country to make sure that they're informed as to the programs, policies, and procedures of the department, and also address concerns or issues that they may have with department officials or programs somewhere across the country.
Well, the concerns and issues you mentioned, that basically at the end of the day, your role is to some sort of a prevent terrorism, in a sense.
Well, the number one priority of the department is to prevent against active terrorism. But looking at security in the way that the U.S. approaches this is that security and the protection of civil liberties have to go hand in hand. And as we see across the U.S. government, both at the FBI, the Justice Department, Department of Homeland Security, security and civil liberties protections go hand in hand. And our job is to work closely with a wide range of community partners to ensure that that's happening.
And how do you find it? Do you find it difficult dealing with the ethnic minorities, especially the Muslim community in America?
After 9/11, Arab and Muslim communities faced high levels of backlash and bias-based crimes. So the Justice Department and the Department of Homeland Security made it a high priority to vigorously investigate and prosecute against any hate crime or bias-based crime against members of those communities, against mosques, against community centers, against religious or cultural institutions in the U.S. And so part of this work involves meeting with members of the community, understanding where they live. Currently, we have robust outreach and engagement programs in 8 to 10 major cities across the country with large Arab, Muslim, South Asian, and Iranian populations.
I give you some figures. In an opinion poll in 2007, 78% of those American Muslims who were questioned said that life had become much harder after 9/11. And also, there's another figure, which is 47% of American Muslims, they see their identity first as a Muslim and second as an American.
Sure.
What does it tell you?
I think that since 9/11, the incidents that we've seen both domestically and internationally have proven that these times from a national security context are especially trying ones. The department has worked with many community-based organizations to help communicate and understand the challenges that communities go through. It's not just Arab and Muslim communities in the U.S. that face challenges, but it's many of these communities. And part of understanding the needs and concerns of a wide range of communities helps the department and other government agencies make better policy and communicate better what our goals and objectives are.
But do you think, are you succeeding in that area?
I think that we have many success stories. For example, in regards to national level or international level terrorism, national security related incidents, we've installed a mechanism at the department in my office that we coordinate and operate that we call the Incident Response Coordination Team. What this is it's a program where we reach out to Arab, Muslim, Sikh, South Asian community leaders from across the country in the aftermath of an incident to communicate any new program or policy of the department, and also listen to concerns, listen to feedback that we're getting from community members from cities from Los Angeles to New York and everywhere in between.
Mr. Salim, and in a survey last year, it seems that 53% of the Americans basically generally think that Islam is a bad religion. Don't you think that you need to work with the Americans rather than the ethnic minorities and the communities?
The job of government is, the job of the U.S. government is not to communicate any certain way on any religion. The job of the U.S. government is to ensure that religious liberty, civil rights, and civil liberties are a fundamental part of the rights that all Americans enjoy.
But at the same time, I mean, after 9/11 and the restrictions imposed, it seems that scared off at least 74% of the American Muslims.
There was indeed increased security screenings and things like that at airports and increased security measures without question. But with that also came new special screening programs, cultural competency training, and other programs for people who wear religious clothing passing through airports and other things of that nature. Part of having an increased, more robust security presence and also having a better understanding of the cultures and religions that live in the U.S.
Which part, which section of the other society? I mean, you said that you're working with various ethnic minorities and religious minorities in America. Which section do you think they are more prone to some sort of extremism and act of terrorism?
I think, as the president said last week, in times of economic hardship, many segments of society can be prone towards some type of violence or criminal activity. What the job of our department and of my agency particularly is to make sure that no community group feels that they're being discriminated or singled out or disparately treated on any issue or program that the department administers. Our job is to communicate the civil liberties protections that are in place and also address grievances that are filed with the department.
But there must be some sort of your kind of government's treatment of the Muslim community somehow harsher than others, because it seems that those people who are really dissatisfied with the situation and unhappy are the Muslims.
Well, I would also point to many success stories that we've had working with Muslim communities in the U.S. across the country in about 10 major cities where my office has robust outreach programs. We've been able to successfully, in the years since 9/11 and in almost 10 years now, we've had many success stories of partnerships and working very closely with Muslim community organizations on a wide range of issues to help promote homeland security and different initiatives that our department has undertaken.
Do you agree, Mr. Salim, that there is Islamophobia in America?
I think that, especially in the past 6 months, incidents like the attempted burning of Qurans in Florida, as well as other incidents, prove that this is a period of certainly heightened tensions. The good news about times of heightened tensions is there are offices like the Civil Rights Division at the Justice Department, like my office at Homeland Security, that are there to strictly enforce, investigate, and prosecute hate crimes or bias-based crimes wherever they occur in the U.S. Part of the U.S. Constitution, part of our federal system, ensures that the rights and liberties of ethnic and religious minorities need to be protected at all costs in the U.S.
So is there any... there's been any changes from the policy that adopted by the previous administrations and what the current administration is
with regard to what specifically?
With regard to this, the kind of work that you're doing,
There has been a continued very strong enforcement of civil liberties, protection against backlash, protection against hate crimes. Those type of protections have spanned both administrations and have been part of the U.S. Constitution federal system that federal agencies like the Justice Department have been vigorously enforcing since the signing of the 1964 Civil Rights Act in the U.S.
But the cases that you mentioned, the case of the pastor Terry Jones, said basically we must send a clear message to the radical element of Islam. And this is not just him saying that.
Sure. What we see in acts of hatred and bigotry like that is nobody benefits from those type of actions. We saw the Secretary of Defense personally call the pastor. We saw General Petraeus overseas make statements how an action like that would in fact harm and endanger U.S. troops abroad. given the heightened tensions in this area, government protections of civil liberties, as well as the rhetoric that we choose to use, needs to be in line with our policies and procedures of both increased security and the protection of civil liberties.
But Mr. Salim, what the American government is doing,
yes,
actually to tell this, what you just yeah. said, to the people like Terry Jones and yeah. his supporters, and the people who are probably not his supporters, but nevertheless, they have that kind of ideas.
Hate-filled rhetoric and hate speech are protected by the First Amendment. That's an unalienable constitutional right in the U.S. However, actions like the pastor was going to take and other similar incidents that are of that nature don't contribute to the safety and security of American troops overseas or their safety or security in the U.S.
But despite all this, yes. Mr. Salim, the American Muslims are feeling and saying in so many words that they are feeling very isolated in the American society.
That may be the numbers that the polls reflect,
yeah.
but the reality that we're seeing on the ground, the cities that we work in consistently, just last week I was in Detroit, Michigan, the home of the largest concentration of Arab Americans in the United States, estimated over 500,000 persons. I had over 4 days of meetings with a wide range of religious, secular, and advocacy organizations. What we're seeing on the ground in cities like Detroit across the country is a commitment from those communities to consistently and regularly engage in a productive and proactive way with security agencies. What American Muslim and Arab communities have seen in the years since 9/11 is that being part of the process, working with federal agencies, is a way that they can achieve security for communities in the U.S. as well as internationally. All communities in the U.S., whether Arab, Muslim, or other, you know, have a joint interest in working closely with government agencies in partnership, not separation. This isn't an us and them. This is an American society coming together to work jointly on American security interests.
I mean, how long have you been in this job now?
I've been at Homeland Security just over 4 years.
Over 4 years?
Yes.
And do you have any facts and figures to show that you've been successful and the attitude in America has changed a little bit? Or at least within the Muslim community, you've changed?
You know, when we're measuring success in a yeah. security context, you don't measure success by attitudes. You measure success by safety and protection. And when we look at our record of safety and protection in the U.S., especially on U.S. soil, since 9/11, our record is very strong. If you look at the criminal and terrorist-related prosecutions and convictions that the Justice Department has made in the past 2 years alone, we have a very strong record on prosecutions and convictions. Even 2 weeks ago, 3 weeks ago, there was a case where there was a young man who was plotting to put bombs on subways in the Washington, D.C. metro area. This is one of the cases that was thwarted early, that the FBI oversaw, and now this person's currently in prosecution proceedings. What we see here by an example of this case and others, that our commitment to security across the country still remains very strong.
Is the American government really worried about domestic terrorism and kind of extremism from the Muslim community?
The U.S. government is not worried about extremism from one particular community. What the U.S. government is interested on and what our paramount responsibility is protecting national security both at home and abroad. When we work with Arab, when we work with Muslim, when we work with South Asian or other communities across the country, working with them isn't to thwart acts of terrorism. Working with them is in partnership against violence and our commitment to civil rights and civil liberties.
But which part of the Muslim community, I mean, which kind of Muslim is more vulnerable and prone? I mean, let's compare with Europe, for example. In Europe, mainly, there are people who are, they're born here. There are people who are born to the Muslim families from Pakistani community, for example, or there are some converts.
Sure.
What about the situation in America?
I mean, when you look at integration across the U.S., you know, the current model that we have is often referred to as a melting pot, but in fact, a modern-day analogy of integration of immigrant communities is in fact more like a mosaic. What we see is people from all countries, races, and religions who have immigrated to the U.S., like my parents who did. They're part of this mosaic of the American landscape. I mean, the American dream for immigrant communities is still very true. And that same pattern of integration in many European countries has not been as successful. What we see in the U.S. is that American values transcend many racist cultures and religions. And that's something that we're committed to upholding.
Do you, the American government and yourself know exactly what's causing the radicalization of the Muslim community, especially the younger generation?
This is an ongoing issue for both the security agencies as well as even academia and think tanks. What we're seeing is a wide variety between the scope and nature of domestic and international incidents. The cases of 7/7, London, Glasgow here in Europe, the thwarted transatlantic plot, as well as the domestic incidents, to include the Times Square bomber, to include the shootings at Fort Hood. Each of these acts of terrorism has a different background, different actors, and different ways that they've taken shape. We're still trying to understand, both from a security perspective and from academia, what drives all these different acts, if they're connected at all, and if they're not. But there's no solution to say this is what's causing violent extremism. That's still an unanswered question.
What about the American foreign policy in the past? I mean, this is something that's constantly argued by the Muslim community, saying that the American foreign policy is at least provoking some section of the Muslim community.
Violence for any cause or motivation against innocent civilians is illegal and unjust across the board. What we see happening, especially in the U.S., and abroad, is a strong commitment from the U.S. security agencies and the U.S. government to work with our foreign allies. I mean, even in part of the program that I'm here today with, and I'm in the U.K. Visiting the U.S. embassy, I'm visiting a number of Arab and Muslim communities across the United Kingdom, talking about our work with Arab and Muslim communities in the U.S. Our partnership on these issues, working both transatlantically as well as internationally in other European countries and in the Middle East as well, is a way that we want to show our commitment for both human and civil rights domestically and abroad.
Do you think when President Obama promises that the American policy, the Americans' standing in the Muslim world is going to change, and they have a different kind of attitude and stance towards the Muslim countries? He said it in many occasions, sure, including in Cairo and all that. Do you think that's not some sort of admission that the foreign policy in the past has been wrong?
You know, when we talk about foreign policy, I think there are many ways you can frame this conversation, but the way that would be most useful, I think, for this context, is to look at the new changes that this administration have instilled. Look at the speeches that have been given in Cairo, in Istanbul. Look at the statements that have been made currently, just this past week in India. The president made, again, reaffirmed his unwavering commitment to working for aid and security with Pakistan and with India. I mean, this is the type of rhetoric and this is the type of dialogue that proves that regardless of where in the world American interests lie, whether it's India or Pakistan, our interests there are unshakable, as well as many of the things that we've recently seen from the White House reinvigorating the peace process with the Israelis and Palestinians.
In your dealing with the ethnic communities, especially the Muslim communities, do you ever come across this kind of argument confronting you, saying that the foreign policy is the cause of all this?
This is, in fact, an example of how integrated and well-advanced ethnic and religious communities are in the U.S. Arab and Muslim communities in the U.S. that we've deal with have a very high level of education, annual income, in fact, more so than the per capita American public. The communities in the U.S. work hand-in-hand with members of Congress, the national-level advocacy organizations that work in Washington and across the country to advance the causes and issues of their communities are, in fact, very well advanced. The communities that we work with raise domestic homeland security issues with us. The U.S. federal system is very large, and the communities have, very aware of what departments handle which issues. And I guess I would defer that question more to my State Department colleagues.
Mm-hmm. Okay. You mentioned that in your dealing with the various ethnic communities, you also work with the Iranians?
Yes. There's, in fact, a large Persian Iranian population in Southern California, mm-hmm. and they've been an active part of our outreach and engagement efforts there for over 6 years.
Yeah. What exactly do you do with them?
Quarterly or more, mm-hmm. 4 to 5 times a year, my office, the Office for Civil Rights and Civil Liberties, Homeland Security, in coordination with a number of other federal agencies, including the Customs Protection, TSA, the Justice Department, and others, we hold quarterly meetings or roundtables. And the one in Los Angeles is the example I'll give you. Part of this program is to provide new information on programs, policies, or procedures of the department. listen to feedback on those, answer any questions, as well as listen to concerns that communities may have regarding airports, airline travel, international, anything related with the Homeland Security mission.
What about the Afghan community? I mean, there are lots.
We work extensively, as I said before, we work extensively with a number of communities in many cities across the country. We have established mechanisms for outreach and engagement in 8 to 10 major cities across the country with a wide range of ethnic and religious diaspora communities.
Yeah, one area that there's been a great deal of concern in the West altogether, and I'm sure that's the case in America, is the use of internet by the extremism, by the extremist activists. Do you have a plan to confront that? Because some of these basically providers and servers are based in America.
As it stands right now, the new paradigm, as we've been discussing, of national security related issues, of radicalization on the internet and in other venues and other means, is in fact a growing concern for the US government. There is no one single policy or issue that I can say that this is the way we're addressing it. I would say fundamentally in our outreach and engagement efforts, one of the things that we're committed to doing and that we have been doing for a number of years now is working with parents, working with teachers, working with families across the country to inform their to inform them that they need to monitor the time that their children are spending online, and that this is the type of thing that where their children can be on websites that they don't want them on, as well as falling prey to victims and scams and other things of that nature. So there is no one solution to extremist websites. It's an issue we're continually working on, continually looking at, and in the meantime, we're working closely with community-based organizations to spread awareness that these sites do in fact exist, and they need to monitor time that their children and young people are spending on those sites.
And do you have some sort of a coordination with Europe, with European countries as well on that?
Part of the coordination that we have is the Department of Homeland Security's relationship with the Home Office here and many other EU partner countries. Just several weeks ago, we had a conference in Brussels where we met with EU partner countries to talk about the role of engaging civil society in this national security context. Part of my trip here is working closely with my colleagues at the Home Office to communicate our level of engagement with ethnic and religious communities in the U.S., vice versa here. I'll be visiting many Arab and Muslim communities in the U.K. as well, discussing and learning from my counterparts in the Home Office best practices and vice versa in the U.S.
But despite all that, Mr. Salim, as I said before, it seems to be that the Islamophobia in America is really at a dangerous level.
Yes.
To the extent that even President Obama himself is being a victim of that as well. I mean, in the recent the opposition, the very far right opposition to President Obama, describing him as a Muslim, establishing first that Islam is a bad religion, and then accusing him of being a Muslim.
Yeah.
So, I mean, what generally, what the policy of the United States of America is towards that?
You know, there is no specific policy on hate speech. Again, the American Constitution protects freedom of speech at all levels. Where there is concern and where there causes issues for security agencies specifically is the advocacy of violence or the criminal or violent act themselves. You know, having a hateful or bias-filled perspective, as abhorrent that it is not illegal in the U.S. You know, we're a country that was founded on principles that at the time seemed radical. You know, our First Amendment constitutional rights are enshrined behind this concept of freedom of speech, freedom of thought, freedom of expression. And so while I disagree with those perspectives, they're legal and constitutional underneath U.S. laws.
Know that the Republican in America have some sort of upper hand in terms of the hierarchy of the power in America. Are you worried that there may be a kind of increase in sort of Islamophobia, especially that many of the Republicans are advocating some sort of action, military action against Iran, for example?
Yeah, I mean, I can speak on the domestic front, and I know that our relationship, the department's relationship with both parties has been very strong throughout this administration. I know that in the change of power, both in the House, has been something that the Republican leaders have already engaged with Department of Homeland Security officials. We're committed to working with the leadership in the House and the leadership in the Senate and White House in this concept of national security. And I think we can only wait until the new Congress comes in to say any more.
Thank you very much, Joe Salim, for being the guest of Be'Ibarat Digar. Thank you very much.
Thank you.